Good morning. My name is Bill Jolly. I'm one of the elders here at Redeemer, and I'm glad to be part of this online service with you. In today's worship post, which you can access alongside this video, you'll find our worship guide and news along with our Connect card. If you're new, take a minute and let us know that you were part of this service. We'd love to pray for you. Just shoot an email to prayer@redeemercommunity.com. At the end of the service, we'll be receiving communion together, so you may want to go ahead and grab what you need. Whatever you have on hand is fine. Now, as you know, we are living in the midst of historic and heart-rending times. Not only are we facing the challenges of a global pandemic, but our nation is also being confronted with its long-standing tolerance of systematic racism and injustice. Today, Jeff Martin will be addressing that issue in his message. But as we begin our service, let's turn our hearts and minds toward God. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 65. What mighty praise, O God, belongs to you in Zion. We will fulfill our vows to you, for you answer our prayers. Though we are overwhelmed by our sins, you forgive them all. What joy for those you choose to bring near. You faithfully answer our prayers with awesome deeds, O God, our Savior. You are the hope of everyone on earth. Would you pray with me? Father, we ask that you would open up our hearts and minds. Open us up to the power and presence of the Holy Spirit and to the grace and truth in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Again, we are glad that you've joined us for worship today.
Through every battle, through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress, you are my portion. You are my hiding place, but I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. The truth. believe you are. Darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew and hear my cry for mercy. Were you to count my sinful ways, how could I come before? Yet full forgiveness meets my gaze. I stand redeemed by grace alone. I will wait for you. I will wait for you on your word. I will rely. I will wait for you. Surely wait for you until my soul is satisfied. So put your hope in God alone. Take courage in His power to save. Completely and forever one. Hold back Christ emerging from the grave.
Through the storm and through I don't know if you could hear that, but we recorded those songs on Monday. And as the last song finished, as the music was kind of fading out, to the band's surprise, the team's surprise, they're hearing chants. And as it got clear and clear, it was people chanting Black Lives Matter. And so in the midst of this, we know that this sermon's coming at a contentious time. And we're actually starting a brand new series for the summer. For the next 8 weeks, we're doing a series called Head On. And Head On is where we're addressing questions, objections to our faith. It's really for maybe you're a skeptic, a doubter, or a critic, or maybe these are questions you're a Christian, you've heard them, and you just didn't know how to respond, or maybe these are questions that that you have, but you're almost timid to even vocalize them. And I just want to say it's okay to have these questions, right? But we want to answer questions that people are asking. And so today we're going to tackle a question around racism. A question that I received this week is just, why are white Christians so apathetic towards race? I mean, if white Christians are pro-life, then why aren't they anti-racism, especially when people are dying? And look, I get it. The conversation around race is divisive. We've covered a lot of touchy topics at Redeemer, and I thought our COVID re-entry strategy was going to be divisive. And the more conversations I've had this week, the more I realize that today is going to be hard. And the reason being is that if there was a sliding scale, people are all across the board. You know, on one side, you have those who think this is a lie that people have bought into hook, line, and sinker. On the other side, you have people who said this is the singular most important issue, period. And then in between, there's a lot of people who feel stuck. They almost feel like to be for one means you have to be against the other, and they're kind of for both and don't know what to say to that. And so I just want to be upfront as we address racism today, that this is not anti-government or anti-police. I'm not trying to defund the police. I don't think that should happen. I believe that God has been in control of our elected officials, and I want to honor and respect them. And honestly, I know quite a few people in law enforcement, and the vast majority of them, I believe, are good. Yes, there are some people who are bad apples, who are doing wrong, but I think the vast majority are good. So I in no way want someone who is pro-law enforcement to feel like we're trying to rally against that. That's not what's going to happen here. I also don't want you to think that this is anti-patriotic, but I do want us to be a people who can love our country enough, a country that God has called us to. And we could have been born anywhere, but we were born here, or we are here, and it's by God's grace that we get the freedoms we have. But I want us to love our country enough to look at some things through a critical eye, right? But with that being said, let me pray for us, because I know I need it, but I think your hearts need it too. So let me pray. God, things are a mess. People have been hurting, and people are crying out. Some things are being protested peacefully, and others have not been. God, there are so many issues in the world, and this is a big one. And God, as we address and talk about a biblical perspective on racism and how we as your followers need to approach it, God, I ask that you would give us wisdom, that you would change our hearts to be more like yours, and that, God, I pray that the words that I say this morning are from you, that they're not from me, and if they are from you, that you would empower them to bring about change in us. God, it's in your holy name we pray. Amen. Well, hey, let me ask you a question real quick before we start diving in. If you could be in God's presence, I mean, where you felt shoulder to shoulder with God, is that a place you'd want to be? If you could experience God's presence in a powerful way, is that something you'd want? I know I would. Sometimes we need to withdraw for that to happen. Sometimes we need to climb the mountain. We need to get away. We need to retreat. We need to pull away from all of the busyness and distractions of life. But other times, it's not about climbing high as much as it is coming low, where we get down on our knees and scrape ourselves, where we get dirt underneath our fingernails. And so let me read to you a story out of Matthew chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25, this is Jesus speaking. He says, starting in verse 31, he says, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will place the sheep on his right, but the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world.' Then he says this, 'For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me.' Then the righteous will answer, 'When? When did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you?' And the king will answer him, 'Truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me.'" And then he goes, let me finish this out. He says, "Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not welcome me. Naked and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, you did not visit me.' Then they also will answer saying, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and not minister to you?' Then he will answer them saying, 'Truly, I say to you, as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." I read this not because I want to unpack every verse and get into the details. I just want that to sit with you for a second. As you hear these words from Jesus, what's happening in your own heart? Where's your mind going? What's stirring in you? Because something I see here is that if we want to be in the presence of God, there's something about that that takes place when we're with the marginalized. Because Jesus placed himself with those who were oppressed, with those who were pushed to the side, with those who had no voice. And why did he do that? Why did he position himself that way throughout his ministry? Because God created all people equal in dignity, value, and worth. Like, we are all created equal. And so when those are pushed to the side and not treated equal, Jesus was with them and serving them. And so if we want to be like Christ, we want to do the same. And as we reach to the hurting, we will find ourselves in the presence of God, because that's where he is at work. Okay, let me make a statement here. As followers of Christ, we must be definitively against racism. We have to call it what it is. It is a sin. And we need to seek justice for all. In any moment in history where that has not been true of the church has not been true to Christ. In Micah 6:8, a prophet in the Old Testament, he writes, "He has told you, O man, what is good." He's talking about God has revealed to us what's good, what God looks at and says, that's good. He has revealed to you what is good. And what does the Lord require? What does God want us to do with our lives? But to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. Do justice, love kindness, walk in humility. You see, these are things that God wants us to do. He wants us to pursue justice, to seek justice for people, all right? And as we do that, notice it doesn't say just go after justice, do it at all costs, run after it. No, it says to do it in a posture of empathy, where we love kindness and walk in humility, all right? So we want to seek justice for the marginalized through a posture of empathy. So I've got 4 points today, 4 points. Three are on empathy, one is on doing justice. I'll just give you the outline. It's listen, learn, lament, link arms. Okay, listen, learn, lament, link arms. 4 points. Let's start with listen. Okay, in James 1:19, we're told to be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. So let's talk. So the first thing we can do for empathy is to listen well. Where we might ask a question, but then our mouths, they shut and we lend our ear. Okay, we want to start listening. And if we're going to listen, that's going to require two things. It's going to require presence. It's going to require humility. What I mean by presence is our greatest resource. If we're talking about how do I get my mind right? How do I know what's happening? How do I understand this stuff better? The listening aspect, the greatest resource we have is friendships we already have. The greatest resource is the friendships we already have. So that means that to start having conversations with our friends who are different than us, okay? To start having conversations. And let me just tell you this, as you're, like I said, this is our chance to maybe ask a question and then just to zip it as we listen. Just a tip that I think is so helpful is do your best. And this isn't going to make or break it, but it's helpful. Do your best not to ask why questions, because we're trained from a very early age that when someone asks us why, that we are defending ourselves. So if you want to just kind of do your best to kind of create an environment where no one's defensive, don't ask why questions, but ask what questions, how questions, you know, what led to that? Or how does that make you feel? What and how questions will help the process of listening by relieving that defensiveness, okay? But the next thing is it requires humility. So as you're asking questions, as you're having conversations, as you're in a place to listen, don't walk in thinking you've got it all figured out. Don't walk in thinking that you already know the answer or no one's going to change your mind. Because if that's the way that you approach a conversation, you're never going to feel deeply for anybody other than yourself. Okay, so be aware of the assumptions you're bringing into the conversation. Be aware of where you are prone to being defensive or dismissive. Approach this not only with your presence, but with a humble presence. And here's what's going to happen. The result of listening, it's twofold. On one hand, when you think about all the stuff that our Black brothers and sisters have been through, there's been so much that is just dehumanizing. Okay, if you study history, dehumanizing. Now, what happens is the things that the circumstances, the things that are happening in our world right now trigger that. Okay, it triggers the trauma. And so it opens a wound. And so when we listen, it gives us an awareness of where someone has been wounded. When we listen, the result is it gives us an awareness of where someone has been wounded. Then the second result is that it builds trust through empowering their voice. When you listen well, not hear, but listen in your presence and with humility, right? Not only are you gaining an awareness of where they've been wounded, but you're starting to build relational trust because your listening is empowering their voice. So the first thing we need to do is just to listen, to be quick to listen and slow to speak. All right, so listen, the next thing is learn. We want to educate ourselves on God's heart for biblical justice. We want to learn. We want to educate ourselves on God's heart for biblical justice. We don't want other people to define justice for us. We need to know what God longs for. And so, I mean, a crazy book in the Old Testament, Leviticus, kind of hard to make it through without some maybe guidance there. But a lot of Leviticus, I mean, there's chapters designated to God's heart for justice. We see that heartbeat go into the prophet Isaiah. Read chapter 61 of Isaiah. I read to you guys from Micah 6:8. You see this heartbeat of God throughout the Old Testament into the New Testament, where he longs for biblical justice. So educate your heart on God's heart, okay? Educate your heart on God's heart for biblical justice. The next thing is, I would say, educate yourself about the history of racism in America. Begin to educate yourself about the history of racism in America. I'll tell you this, my knowledge of Black history is not where it should be. And the truth is that my Black friends have been studying history and studying white people their whole lives. And I've got blips of Black history throughout my education, but like, I'm just now starting to learn more about where they're coming from. And so I'm behind the eight ball in this thing, right? But we want to educate ourselves about the history that has shaped the way they experience and view the world. And so you're like, what do I need to learn? Well, what do you know about the slave trade? What do you know about life on plantations? What do you know about, as you look through that, like Emancipation Proclamation? What do you know about 40 acres and a mule? Right? Well, they gave them 40 acres and a mule. Do you know what happened a year after that was passed when Lincoln left office? Oh yeah, they took it back. All right, like, what do you know about Juneteenth, when slaves were set free later than the Emancipation Proclamation in Texas and Louisiana? What do you know about the 3/5 clause in the Constitution, where they weren't even seen as fully human? What do you know about civil rights? What do you know? Like, so start to educate yourself and understand what's happened historically that has begun to shape the way our brothers and sisters experience and view the world. And I know some people say, like, I'm not a racist. Look, just because you're not a racist doesn't mean that you aren't part of an environment that is cultivating an atmosphere for racism to still exist, right? Just because you aren't a racist doesn't mean that you are part of an environment that's cultivating an atmosphere that is allowing racism to still exist. Okay. And so here's what happens. The more you educate yourself, the more you'll see how things of the past are still affecting people today. So we want to educate ourselves. After that, lament. Romans 12:15 tells us to rejoice with those who rejoice and to weep with those who weep. This means that with broken hearts, we want to begin to cry out to God on behalf of those who are hurting. It's a time to lament, right? So empathy, right? It starts when we listen. It gets better when we begin to learn, and it begins to manifest itself when we enter lament and feel and hurt where they are feeling and hurting, right? And that brings us to the fourth point. The fourth point is, it's time to link arms. It is time to link arms. I went to the beach a couple of weeks ago with some friends, and there was this crazy tide, rip tide, that was going parallel to the shore, which would have been kind of fine, except for there was, to the side, there was a pipe that ran out about a quarter mile into the ocean, and that was the exit kind of that you could see there, and it was held up by this cement pylons. It was marked off by these wood pillars. And so what was happening is that tide was running people directly into that pipe, which created kind of like a dangerous strainer. And so midway through the day, I'm out there with my wife, Lucy, and we're watching this kid on a boogie board, and he just kind of starts drifting. And I'm looking at her, I'm like, is anybody going to get this kid? Like, and then eventually he gets caught full blown into it. He starts screaming for help. And I'm like, where are this kid's parents? And he's probably 4th, 5th grade. And so I yell at you, get a lifeguard. And I run out into the ocean and jump in and swim after this kid. And I get him, I kind of come under his chest, and I'm holding him, and his heart's just, it's beating. And I'm sitting there, and we're getting slammed into this pipe. And I'm like, okay, I don't know where to go. I can't just ride this current out. I'm unable to swim any direction with him, and he's hysterical. And so I try to create a ladder with my body for him to climb on top of one of these pylons. I'm like, you got to climb up. And he just couldn't figure that out. And so And so meanwhile, what's feeling like eternity is we're just getting beat by waves and slammed into this pipe and this cement pylons. People from shore, complete strangers, began to create a human chain to get out to us. Right? Eventually, some lifeguards came and saved us. Turns out, even without the kid holding onto him, I'm still not strong enough to swim. Kind of humbling, right? But I think about, man, complete strangers creating a human chain because they saw someone in need. Look, there are image bearers of God right now who are crying out, I can't breathe. And it is time for us to link arms. And as we do that, we're going to get scraped up and bruised. I mean, when I was in the water, I mean, I bruised my kneecap. I cut my hands. I inhaled so much salt water that once I got out of the ocean and collected myself, I puked salt water because it was so when you link arms, it's going to require sacrifice. And when you sacrifice, when you enter into someone's suffering, into their hurts, into their sorrows, the truth is you lose a piece of yourself. But you come out more human on the other side. And so, Christians, I'm asking you right now, would you link arms? It's time to lament. It's time to link arms. Okay? Now, maybe you're saying, like, well, what can I do? That's been the burning question. I've asked people, found out that's not the best thing to do, apparently. It's like, you got Google. What can you do? There's small things. You know, parents, how diverse does your kid's toy collection look? Is it a bunch of white Barbies? You can start changing that so that they view the world through their toys more ethnically diverse. You could start writing letters or making phone calls. When you see people who are experiencing injustice or racism, you can contact your elected officials on their behalf. Maybe it's bigger. You're like, okay, I think you can run for office, right? Maybe you're like, I need to run. But really, the kind of the resounding thing that I feel throughout the conversations I've had is that it's time for a conversation. It's time for us to start having conversations, which means it's time to listen. Those conversations are times we can learn. Those conversations should result in our lamenting. And those conversations will also help us to link arms. Look, I long for Redeemer. When we gather in worship, I long for it to look like heaven. I want to walk into this room and just see diversity, right? I want to get a little uncomfortable with that and then get comfortable with it. I long for that. But here's where God's convicted me this week. Redeemer will never look like heaven on a Sunday until all of our dinner tables start looking like heaven throughout the week. It's time to start building some bridges. It's time to start having some conversations. It's time to link arms. Look, I know at the end of the day, I know deeply that this is not anything a political system can fix or a policy, because it's a sin issue. And sin has destroyed our hearts and broken us. And we are longing for eternity. But as we long for eternity, I don't want to miss the present hour. So it's time to link arms. In John 11, Jesus, his best friend, passes away. And in this moment, when he finally gets to the tomb, we get the shortest verse in the Bible. It says, Jesus wept. And Jesus knew what he was about to do. He knew what he had the power to do, that he would just call into that tomb and say, Lazarus, get up, walk out, and that he would get up and walk out. But he still wept. Why? Well, one, he was crushed because he could see what his friends were going through. He could feel, he empathized with them. But two, is he knew that sin had entered the world and created brokenness. It fractured our relationship with God. It fractured our relationship with each other. It fractured our relationship with creation. It's just destroyed and messed everything up. And in the ultimate picture of that brokenness is death. Death is not how God created things to be. And so he knew that what he was witnessing was not right. But he also knew that to reverse it would cost him his own life. So Jesus lived the perfect life we could never live. He died the death, the sinner's death that we deserved. Then he rose victoriously from the grave, not only to save our lives for eternity, right? Not just to save us from eternal punishment, but to save us for living today. Jesus also died to take everything that's broken and to make it new. So let's look to Jesus as our only hope. Let's strive to be like him. And let's be like him, even if it means getting low, scraping our knees, getting bruised up, and getting dirty. Because Jesus is with the marginalized. You see, as we have done to the least of these, we've done to him. God, thank you. Thank you for your guidance. Thank you for your wisdom in the midst of the crisis that we face. Now we know this breaks your heart. We know that you long for something better and that you will one day complete that. But you've also invited us to take part in what you're doing to shape this place to look like heaven. And God, that's not in us. We don't have the strength to pull that off. But Christ in us does. As we look to the cross today and remember Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, God, let us also remember his guaranteed presence with us in this cultural hour. So God, help us in the power of Christ and the strength of Christ to link arms and to move forward and to build bridges, both for social justice, but also for people to know saving grace. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. Well, at Redeemer, we love to respond with the Lord's Supper. Obviously, that's something we would much rather do in person than virtually, but we're together in spirit right now. And so we take bread and remember that Jesus' body was broken or given because of our sin. He went to the cross to save us. And the truth is that there might be some things we need to repent of right now. And so here in a little bit, as we wrap up the service and you have time to take communion, I want to encourage you to ask God, is there any sin that I need to ask your forgiveness of? Is there something I need to repent of, especially when it comes to either racist tendencies that might live beneath the surface, maybe that are explicit, or maybe it's just simply turning a blind eye or just being part of an environment that's creating an atmosphere to cultivate the possibility of this existing, right? So take time. But then as you take the cup and remember that Jesus' blood sealed a new covenant, that covenant is this, that God's love for you is not from what you can do, but from what Jesus has done. Which means that God loves you now as much as he ever will. His love is steadfast and maxed out. Whether you're having the best week or the worst week or somewhere in between, you are loved fully and forever always because of Christ and Christ alone. Hey, hope to see you next week as we continue this series head on. I promise you, we'll be tackling another hard question. So dig in and get ready. Love you guys. And hey, I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you as we walk through these dark hours. See you guys.
Thanks again for being with us. It's good to be together. It's a means of grace. Thanks also for your faithful giving. The gospel continues to go out through your financial support. For those of you who would like to join our giving community, you can text RCCJC to 77977. Now, as you take communion, there'll be some light music playing and you'll have plenty of time. There's no need to hurry. Here's our benediction from Revelation 7, 9 through 10. After this, I saw a vast crowd too great to count from every nation and tribe and people and language standing in front of the throne and before the Lamb. They were shouting with a great roar, "Salvation comes from our God who sits on the throne and from the Lamb." That Lamb is Jesus Christ. Look to him as you take the bread and the cup. Grace and peace.
your eyes to heaven, see the Holy One eternal. Behold the Lord of Majesty, exalted in his temple. As symphonies of angels praise, now strain to sound his glory. Come worship all before his grace, the King in all his beauty.
How worthy.
How worthy. How worthy. How worthy. The King in all his beauty. Now sing the King who wears a crown, one made of shame and splendors, the sacrifice for ruined man, the substitute for sinners. As earth is stained with royal blood and quakes with love and fury, he breathes his last and bows his head, the King.